The following broadcast was produced by the Lighthouse for the Blind in San Francisco as part of our Lighthouse Learning Library.
We talk about the right things to do in employment, but now we're going to talk about, how are we being? So you notice that we're called human beings and not human doings, right? So we spend very little time, sometimes in North America, anyway, in the North American culture, looking at our level of consciousness and who we're being while we're busy doing all the things that we're doing. What is the vibe? What is the energy? Where are we coming from? What is the intent while we're communicating with somebody? We've heard our whole lives, it's not so much what you say, it's in the way that you say it. So there's a lot of energy put behind what we say. And Christine, the massage therapist, would know. I'm a massage therapist as well. And there's so much of our touch that you could get into an area that maybe you shouldn't be into, or something slips, or you just, they're turning over at the same time your hand was passing over, and so we get taught a lot in school about intention of touch. And if you touch somebody in an area that's kind of in their business that you shouldn't have been in, that they will know as the client that your intent was not sexual. So there's a lot about, so we can take that kind of attention and study our intent in communication. What is our intent when we go into a job interview? So it's really an interactive conversation. And I've got, some possible, I call them personal distinctions to throw out to you guys. And I'm happy to abandon my agenda at any time to go with what's going on in the room. Okay? So it really is your time. So one of the things that I wanted to start with is the idea of knowledge. And nothing meant against the day that we've spent looking at knowledge. But how many people, and you're going to have to do everything by, snaps of fingers or clapping or what have you, because I won't see a hand up. And I'm going to be really big on names, who's speaking to for you guys as a way to get to know each other and start that bonding. Okay, so if someone's speaking, I'm going to say, who is that? Okay, so give us a first name. So how many people in here would like to lose weight? Yeah? All right. I'm going to have to get someone to clap for me, too. My hands are full or I'd be clapping. And thank you. And how many of you know exactly what to do to lose weight? Yeah. So you notice that the information isn't making a difference, right? You all know how to do it and you all want to do it, but the information isn't making a difference. So it's going back to that maybe who you're being about your intention to lose weight, or your conversation around food, or your conversation around clothing is really what gets in the way of you losing weight, because it's clearly not the information, yes? Right. It's not a lack of information. It's not the wrong kind of information. Like, oh, I just haven't studied that yet. The knowledge is out there, right? So we're gonna look at growing your person. Often when you're looking for a job, I feel a little bit like it's being in combat. And you wouldn't go into combat without training, would you? So why go into this whole huge endeavor called gainful employment, a career path, without training? So there are a couple different ways you could listen as we're going through the week. This will apply to any of the sessions, really, but the coaching. You can listen a particular way, actually, to this whole week. You can listen like you have it all figured out and you already know it. Or you can listen like, maybe this is an opportunity for me to take a look and to, yes, maybe I may hear some stuff I've already heard, but it's in the listening that will make the difference for you. Might make the difference for you is how are you listening? Some people listen through a filter like, oh yeah, I've heard it all, yada, 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 right? Oh yeah, been there, done it, bought the t-shirt, right? There's this listening that's kind of shut down. So that's a little bit about listening. Anybody, can you see how you tend to listen to people, to family members, to... You ever notice people, some people in your life, you get an opinion about somebody, like, you know, they're kind of ditzy, yeah. Right? And the next time they open up their mouth, what do you hear?
Ditzy.
Because you're listening for that, right? It's pre-programmed. It's like you've got great big picture, big filters on your ear shaped like cones. Mm-hmm. And inside the cone is ditzy. So they could just simply say hello and you're like, yeah, whatever, ditzy. Right? All they said was hello and you're already hearing, duh. So it's really good to know, how do you listen? Anyone have an idea? Anyone see like how you tend to listen to something? Anybody want to share? Yeah, go ahead. What's your name?
Kim.
Kim?
Yeah, I try to listen. I don't, you know, when I listen to people, I go by tone. And I've had people say you shouldn't go by tone because, oh, it's a microphone. I've heard people say you should never go by tone because the tone may be wrong. Mm-hmm. They may not be angry. They may be joking or they may just be annoyed. So I have, you know, my parents are the kind of people that they say they're joking, but they sure don't sound like they're joking.
Right.
And they're like, I was joking. I'm like, no, you weren't. You sounded really serious. Mm-hmm. Or then you get those people that, you know, they're like, oh, I'm so sorry that you can't see. And I assume, mm-hmm. well, you really don't know a lot about me then, do you? Like,
so how do you listen to your parents, Kim?
Well, what I do, it's just really hard because they're my parents. I have a tendency... I've learned this the hard way, is I try not to take what they say to heart, because if I do, it's just going to get me frustrated. So if they say a joke and it doesn't sound like a joke to me, I just kind of, oh, ha, ha, yeah, that was funny. Okay, that you were joking. Well, why can't I tell? I mean, I don't say it out loud, but I'm thinking it. When it comes to the public, though, I find it's a lot easier to listen to what the public has to say. If someone's speaking, I do my best, and I mean my very best, not to interrupt them, especially with sighted people, because I've noticed with all of us here, and it's no one's fault, it's just we do it. We interrupt each other all the time, because we want to get a word in, and it's really easy to interrupt each other. But I've noticed when I'm out in the public and I'm waiting for a bus or whatever, and I get into a conversation with someone, the worst thing you can do is interrupt them, because it's like...
I'm going to interrupt you.
Okay.
How do you listen? What's in the listening? Is it stupid? Is it people are wise? Is it that your parents are inappropriate? What's in your listening?
Okay.
What's the filter?
The filter for me, the what I'm hearing is, I'm sorry, can you explain it more? I'm trying to understand what you...
Sure. So let me just go back to anybody. Kim, let me divert for 1 second. Anybody else have a listening?
Here. Jess, yeah. I'm going to come around. Just a second. Here we go.
Okay, Jess.
Hi, this is Jerry.
Oh, Jerry. Sorry, Jerry.
Yeah. Listening, every time I put a filter of I'm going to try to solve their problem, and sometimes people just want me to listen.
Yeah. Yeah. So Jerry's filter is there's a problem to be solved, and I'm on it.
Okay, we got Christina here.
Hi, it's Christina.
Hey, Christina.
Yeah, I have to say about Kim's comment, I agree, because a lot of us as blind people or visually impaired people, we grew up not being listened to and not taken seriously. For me, though, the filter for me, I hear everything, and my mother's voice still rings incredibly loudly in my head. And I hear everything through her filter, and all these wonderful things that we're hearing today and that we're going to hear in the days ahead about, you know, you can do this and you can do that. I can constantly hear my mother's voice inside saying, well, that's not right, or no, you can't. Or and when, you know, blind people talk about you should do this, you should dress like this, you should do this, I can hear my mother going, that's right, Tina. And I'll just say that if anybody calls me Tina, you're dead. But that's what I hear.
So let me just interact with that. It's Christina, right? Okay. So you know, notice in our language that we say, you know, we as visually impaired people and we speak for the group. There are times you really want to claim it and say, I didn't feel heard growing up. Own it, right? I'm not saying that's for you to own, Christina, but that's a great example of I didn't feel heard growing up. Own it. Do you know, instead of third party like we or the group or I've heard other people say that they didn't feel heard, I didn't feel heard, heard growing up, right? Is that accurate, Christina?
I think they're both true, but for me, yes, definitely.
Yeah, so you want to own it. One of the things we're going to talk about tonight is that ownership. Ownership of your feelings, ownership of your thoughts, ownership of the direction that your life is going. All the parts that you like and all the parts that you don't like are yours to own. So let me look at, with you guys, what do you have, and this is an internal question for you, to go inside and think about this, and then I'll ask if anybody wants to share. What do you have at stake this week?
My name is David, and well, I was going to talk about how we filter, but I'm flexible enough. What do I have at stake? I have the rest of my life at stake, in the sense that I want to be able to find something that will sustain both my need to enjoy life, but also to sustain a need in terms of how to work and be with other people. It's not necessarily about the money. It's about being happy.
Yep.
And I want to be happy.
Yeah. So did you hear what he said at the beginning? What I've got at stake is the rest of my life.
Yeah.
But that's what I got at stake. So are you willing to put that at stake this week, David?
I'm sorry. Repeat.
Are you willing to put that at stake?
I'm sorry. What again? I'm sorry. Oh, of course. That's why I'm here.
He's already got that at stake before he even walked through the door this morning. Can you hear that he had that already at stake?
Yes, ma'am.
Who else has? Thank you so much, David. Who else has something at stake for this week? Yeah. Uh-huh.
It's Kim again.
Hey, Kim.
He's so right. I've been wanting a job for a long time, and I've been in college for the last, 6 years? I just graduated with my associate's degree, and I want to go back to get my bachelor's, but more than anything, I want a job, because I am so sick of relying on the government. People say, oh, you've got it so good. I'm like, no, I don't, because I'm relying on the government to say what I can do with my money, what I can't do with my money, and I want to be able to earn my own money, save my own money, and not have a limit as to how much I can save.
Yeah. So Kim, what are you putting at stake?
Pretty much I'm putting at stake what David's putting at stake. I'm putting at stake my life, because my everything, because if I don't find a job, if I don't get these skills to learn how to find a job, then I'm going to be living off the government for the rest of my life, and that's not something I'm willing to do. So I'm taking a week out of my time, which unfortunately I'm not doing much right now, but volunteering is something. And I look at it this way, in that, yes, I'm going to be going back to school in the spring, but if the volunteer position that I'm taking next week becomes a job somewhere down the road, I'll be a fool not to take it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what you have at stake is the rest of your life.
Yes. Yes.
Great. Who else? Thank you, Kim. Who else?
Okay, I'm coming around. Dan.
What do you have at stake, Dan?
This is Dan. Yeah, I have at stake basically the way I look at it is a different beginning. Maybe whether it's a remodel or a new version of Dan 2.0 or whatever.
new and improved Dan.
And I don't stake my life on it, because I refuse to do that, because, and this is part of my filter, is I'm here to filter in positive growth in terms of the way I used to think about job search and the way I'm going to think about job
search.
So that's But to put my whole life into a job, in my opinion, I personally don't think that is ever fair. You know, we should be grateful in this country and in many civilized countries that we have a blind aid, and praise God for that, because it is a positive thing. It gets us through these moments, and you'll work for 10, 15 years, and then you'll go back on it if things still go the way we want it to, and then you go back. That's what it's there for. And I look at it as a positive thing, not a negative.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Anybody else? And let's just stick to, what do you have at stake, you know, 10 words or less? Go. Who's next?
I think you just, you took away my joy. This is Dexter. Because I wanted to comment briefly on the filter and link it to what I have at stake. Could I do that?
10 words or less. Ten. Because we won't get anywhere if we all do 2 minutes on what we have at stake. 20 words. I'll give you 15. How's that?
15 words, Dexter.
All right, go. You drive a hard bargain.
Okay, anybody
go ahead.
Else? Okay, I'm going to come around. Just
Twitter. Tweet it. Go ahead, Dexter.
All right, no.
My name is Derek.
Okay.
And what I have at stake is, again, I think like a lot of people say, an opportunity, another chance at a better class life.
Yeah.
So that's what I have at stake, a life.
Beautiful. Yeah, so when we're saying earlier, people, what they have at stake is their life, we don't mean literally, you know, that. Yes, exactly. Beautifully said. Thank you. Anybody else want to share what they have at stake? Going once? Okay. Going twice?
Okay. Hi, I'm Jessa. And,
hey, Jessa.
I'd like to underline what everyone said about a chance at a better life, but there's also something that needs to be said about confidence that comes from doing something that contributes in a very tangible way to the world that you live in.
What are you putting at stake, Jessa?
I'm putting at stake, that's a hard one, because I would say my life, but I've actually rethought that filter, because
it's not connected to the filter. It's just what you want to put at stake for this week. What do you want to get out of? What are you willing to have at stake, right? What are you willing to put at stake for this week? And it may be, you know, I don't know right now. I mean, that's a fair answer. There's no right answer for this, guys. So it may be, you know, that's a great thing to ponder. I'll get back to you tomorrow morning, right? So you may want to think about that.
Well, I'm willing to throw everything behind it at this point. I mean, it is my main priority in life right now is trying to better my life.
Yeah.
Therefore, I wouldn't say that, I'd say my life would be a lot emptier without a job.
But which means it'll be fuller with one.
Exactly.
Yes.
Exactly.
Okay. Beautiful. Thank you. So quality of life kind of thing again. Anybody who doesn't have anything at stake?
I have something at stake.
Okay, cool. Who's that talking? My
name is Michael.
Michael, okay.
For me, what I have at stake is opportunity. This is a very important opportunity for me to prove that I am job ready and to review a lot of the things that I learned in the immersion program, and that's why I'm here.
Very cool. Thank you.
Okay, and I've got Tommy here.
So, all right, how many more? Okay, go Tommy.
Hi, Julie. Tommy here.
Hey.
What I have at stake. Okay, carpe diem, seize the day, seize the opportunities that are bouncing all around the walls here, and all the different speakers It is. It's an opportunity. And
for so you to do what? What's the opportunity for you?
To challenge myself, to put myself out there and try to finally just get out there and get the job.
Yeah.
So it's a challenge. Challenging
Great.
Myself to take the right steps to do it.
Very cool. So one of the things that I'm going to share, thank you for that, Tommy, is a wonderful, powerful distinction that you can use throughout your life that is called fact versus interpretation. So if you picture two circles and they're beside each other, but they're not on top of each other. So you've got two circles, one on the left called fact, and one on the right called interpretation. And so in the factual world, do you remember years ago, if you've seen old reruns, the what was the guy's name that used to say, "Give me the facts, ma'am, just the facts."
Joe Friday.
All right.
Sergeant Joe Friday.
Absolutely, they can ask questions better. So when they used to go to a scene of a crime, they didn't say, "What is your opinion about what happened?" They would say, "What did you see?" They wanted fact. And if somebody said, "I think it was a male, but maybe a female," not so factual, huh? It's like now we're totally into the circle on the right, which is interpretation. So this is a study of ontology, and ontology is the study of the human being. So we're studying the wiring of the human being, like we study the wiring of a car. If you wanted to know how a car worked, you would get out diagrams, or maybe you'd rip a car apart, or maybe you'd, you know, build a model of how the wiring worked on a car. Or ask your dad to show you the wiring. But you'd have to look at the wiring and which piece connects to what piece and what is the wiring that makes this all work. So here you're going to look at what is the wiring of the human being, what is our nature. And one of the things is interpretation, is that there's fact, the world of fact, and then there is the world of interpretation. And often what we tend to do is collapse the two like an eclipse. Do y'all remember what an eclipse looks like? Mm-hmm. When the sun, the moon completely, or the sun, which is it? The moon blocks out the sun. Okay, all right, get technical on me. Okay, one blocks the other, whatever you call it. So you've got the moon laying over top of the sun, and you can't see the sun because the moon is so big in front of it that you can't see the sun anymore. So the sun and the moon start to look one in the same. Right? So you've laid one circle over top of another circle. Now you don't have two, you have one. And often, I mean, until the day you die, you will be an interpretive creature. So, and by the way, nothing I say is true. It's all distinctions. To try it on like a jacket. If it fits, wear it. If it doesn't, throw it back. So, but try on that we are interpretive creatures. Everything that we hear, everything that we see, everything that we read goes through some kind of interpretation. So it points to it when we ask two or three different witnesses about a car wreck. And nobody can seem to agree. No, the red car pulled out in front of the blue car. No, because the blue car was trying to pass too fast, and the red car, he went to turn right, but then the blue car cut across. And you think, well, everybody was standing there with vision looking at the same thing. How come nobody can agree? Often we can't agree on the same story because, you know, everybody has their interpretation of what they saw in place. So only if you could film it and then go back, actually you'd still get interpretation. Did you see that? No. And it depends what angle you're looking from when you see a car wreck. If you're over on the left versus over on the right, you're going to see, if you're at the back as opposed to the front, you're going to have a different view. So it's all open to that interpretation of the fact. So if we start to play with fact versus interpretation, you can live consciously aware in your life that, hey, I just had an interpretation, it wasn't necessarily fact, and start to separate fact from interpretation. It's a very, very powerful tool that you can take everywhere in your life. And I'm throwing a lot of stuff at you guys because, you know, this could take two and a half hours to go over just this one fact versus interpretation distinction to really get it. I know that you get it cognitively, but I want you to get it experientially. I want you to get it in your gut where the light bulb goes off and you say, oh my goodness, that's what we do. That's how we live. I do that. You know, based on somebody's clothing, we have an interpretation. Based on what I'm saying, oh, she sounds like, or she's a, or I think she's, right? There's all this going on in the background all the time about what we see and hear and read. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Any comments? Anybody sort of trying that on and wrestling with it and saying, I don't know. Microphone's coming your way, Axel. Microphone's coming your way.
Okay. All right. Hello. Yep. So my opinion to that is, this is just a personal perception that based on experience we made in prior phases of our life. You know, that's how we learn that the brain, you know, gets defines the impression of senses or what's left of them. You know, and compares with already experienced information, and then that's where the interpretation results are. So therefore, you have automatically total different viewpoints, given that everybody has his or her individual experience or prior life or past life or whatever.
it's a great point that you bring up because isn't it tricky? You know, when I was in my 20s, life was way more open, and I would go try all kinds of stuff that I look back now. Thank you so much for sharing that, Axel.
No problem.
You know, life was open, and I look back and think some of the stuff that I didn't try, I think, holy cow, I don't think I'd have the nerve to do that now because I've got this experience, so I have to be very careful, I find, with thinking that I know how something's going to go. Because I've got all this wonderful experience and I think, yes, but I can also see where it might be a handicap for me because I'm so busy thinking that I know how things are going to turn out that I actually shut down some opportunity and I don't take it because I already know how it's going to work out. And I think, wait a minute, I didn't do that in my 20s. And I did all kinds of stuff that I look back and think, oh my God, where did I get the nerve to be doing that stuff? So for sure, there's some balance between life experience and the wisdom that you get from life experience and back to the living consciously is to notice. We get the opportunity to notice that, hey, I'm thinking I know how it's going to turn out. So I'm actually not trying certain things because I think I know.
Right, right. Julie, yes. This is Dexter, the interpretation point you were making earlier.
Yeah.
You know, I spent the first, from 7 to 13, I believe, at the School for the Blind. Was a boarding school, so I came home on weekends. Didn't really know my family. When I did move home at 13, 14, My dad died. I grew up with him from 1 to 7. So my siblings, they moved. Dad and my mom were separated, and I had nowhere to sleep. I slept on the floor on a sleeping bag. We were like 10 of us in one room, so my clothes was in a trash bag. So I never felt belonged. I never felt accepted. Mm-hmm. I felt a lot of self-hatred, and I said, you know, it's because of my blindness they're treating me like this. And one thing I said to myself, and I think the point you're making is, like we said, you and I were talking earlier, that we are meaning-making machines
yes.
as human beings.
Yes.
Life, a lot of times, is not what actually happened to us, but is the meaning and the interpretation We give to what happened to us. So my interpretation of that event, having to sleep on the floor as a teenager with my clothes, my clothes in a trash bag, is that I am not worth it.
Yeah.
I felt less than a human being, and I felt very hated and despised by my mom.
Yes.
Now, when I grew up now, and this is, I'm finishing really quickly, and because I thought I wasn't worth it, because I thought that my blindness meant I was less than, I never thought I deserved happiness, because I believe happiness was only for people who were, quote unquote, normal.
Yes.
I mean, it was so bad. 2 years ago, I graduated with my doctorate, and I had no intention of celebrating, no intention of having a party. I found myself throughout life having accomplishments back to back. I'd get a master's, then another master's, and I'll never celebrate. And the reason I didn't do it is because, back to my teenage years, I don't deserve happiness. I'm blind. I'm less than a person, right?
Yeah.
And based on the interpretation I gave to sleeping on the floor. And it's until I came to the place where I had to go back to that place in my life and reinterpret what happened. I said, no, man, are you crazy? Your mom was a single parent. She worked as a cleaner. And you should be privileged that she got a house as a single woman with all those kids. She got a house. You were able to grow up with your family. And there's still a lot of scars because of the experience. But the fact that there was some reinterpretation,
yes,
of what happened, now I deserve happiness. Now I'm traveling and giving myself vacations, and because, yes, I deserve happiness. My blindness doesn't mean I'm less than.
Yeah, right on. Thank you so much for sharing that. Who got value out of that?
Yeah.
Who got value? Yeah. So thank you for sharing that, because what could you hear that where's the fact? Anybody see the fact in the how he grew up? Where's their fact? What's factual about what he shared? Give me one fact. Yes, he slept on the floor. That's
that is
factual or interpretation?
And he achieved a tremendous amount despite all of those obstacles.
No, that's interpretation.
The fact is that his mother was a single parent. And,
yes.
And there were a lot of people in the family.
Is that, okay, so hold on, guys. Let me pull it back. So is that fact that there were a lot of kids in the family?
Yeah.
Yes, interpretation. How many kids were in the family?
He said there were 10. That's a lot of people.
That's interpretation. The fact that there was 10 is factual. You see the difference? Yeah. There were 10 children in the family. Fact or interpretation? Okay, interpretation, there were a lot. Is that interpretation? Yes. Well, that's up to you, though. That's interpretive, though. You just want to know. Don't get caught up in whether 10 is a lot or not. Hey, guys, pull it back to, we've all got awesome stuff. We're going to get to it for sure. I love that you guys are all intrigued with this, but pull it back, because this is such a fantastic example. Don't get caught in whether it's a lot or a little. We want to know that that's interpretation. Fact is that there were 10. Yes?
Yes.
Interpretation, oh, there were a lot. Or, oh, no, from my interpretation, there were just a few. I came from we had 30 in my family.
Okay.
Right? So you see how that's interpretation, right? Sure, judgment can be, yes, interpretation. Interpretation can be, there were a lot. Not necessarily, there's no judgment in that statement, there were a lot. But it's interpretive, right? Now, if you said, what a screwed up mother to have 10 kids, that's judgmental, right? Okay, so he slept on the floor, fact or interpretation?
Fact.
Yes. Interpretation or fact, he did a lot with his life.
Interpretation.
Yeah. What was another fact about his clothing? Right. Now, what do we make that mean? What's the interpretation about clothing in a trash bag as a kid?
He was considered as a trash.
He was considered trash. There wasn't enough room. He's not worthy. Yeah. Right? Unworthy. Maybe unlovable. So we all do this. Dexter's just in touch with what he did.
Yeah.
We all have this. We all have some story, you know, we can all probably mentally shaking our heads thinking, I've been there thinking I'm unworthy because I'm less than other people because I can't see.
But then you,
right?
See, but then you look at the whole of what Dexter's been through and others, and it makes some of what we've been through so much smaller. And so,
that's true.
Is that fact or interpretation? Yeah, yeah. So if you...
you think what others were meant to was greater or lesser than you.
That's all interpretation, though, Kim.
Right, yeah, I know, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, it's all interpretation. Now, somebody over, I think Christina said, is that if it makes you feel good, why not do it? Well, sure, it's not about feeling good or bad or right or wrong. It's about knowing what you just did. And Dexter got in touch with, hey, you know what? This interpretation sucks the life out of me. Yeah. It's disempowering. And nobody did it to Dexter but Dexter. Nobody made that up and said, okay, kid, you better think you're a piece of trash and worthless or else I'm going to pound your head. Yeah. Right? And even if somebody said, I'm going to pound your head, you could say, you can pound my head, but I'm still not going to believe it. So we do it to ourselves. But we want to look exterior and say, look what the world did to me,
yeah.
Right?
So then is interpretation, is it wrong? Because you don't want to interpret, you don't want to, is it wrong to interpret? Because we all do this in that, you know, we see somebody walking down the street and we think, gosh, they must be homeless the way they act. It's like interpretation,
right. It's not about right and wrong, though, because if you take it, but it's a great point that you share, Kim, because don't we kind of relate to it, like right or wrong? Good or bad,
should we or shouldn't we?
White hat or black hat, you know, evil, good, we relate. But if you take it out of that context and just notice, oh, this is the human condition. Yeah. This is what I live in. We're mostly asleep to the fact that we do this. Well, I shouldn't say the fact. We're mostly asleep to that we are interpreting. And so what happened to us as a kid or what circumstances surrounded us as a kid, we're mostly asleep that we got a story about it. We had it mean something about us as a human being because our clothing was in a plastic bag. Like, really? You put clothing in a plastic bag and go, oh my God, I'm nothing? But that's what we do as children. Dexter got the opportunity to go back and say, wait a second, I made up a whole story about my worth as a human being because my clothing was in a plastic bag. Does that make sense as an adult to be doing that?
Kids don't know any better, though.
Sure, but as adults, we live like that story's the truth. We don't necessarily go back often. We don't, most times, we don't go back and say, wow, I really have carried a story about myself for years. Exactly, and that's the whole thing about Kim says, you know, is this a wrong thing to do? No, but no, be aware, consciously be aware. You know, we were commenting tonight leaving the mess hall, the dining hall, saying, wow, look at all the chairs that are pushed out. They're not pushed into the table. And Kathy said, what is that about? And I said, not being present. They're not present. You're not present if you leave your chair out. Now, is it going to happen sometimes? Sure, but all the time? I'm going to guess you're not present.
What do you mean?
You're not in this moment. You're somewhere else thinking, and it's easy to do, right? Oh, God, I got this phone call to do. I got to send a text. I got a text. Oh, I got to send an email. Who called me? Did somebody call me? What's going on? What time is it? Where? Oh, my dog's got to pee. What's happening? Oh, I'm thirsty. I got to go to the washroom. We're not in this moment aware necessarily, right, of should I push my chair in?
Yeah.
I'm in this moment, right. And we were joking, like, doesn't everybody hate that that's visually impaired, that you leave the chair out?
Yeah.
But guess what? We're not present. If we're leaving a chair out, I'm going to guess we're not in that moment.
Or we forget.
We tend to be stuck in the future or the past.
Yes. Yes. Sure. Sure. It could be. It's conditioning, right? Okay. Hold on a sec, guys. We got somebody at the mic.
This is George. It's been said that feelings are real. They're in the present. They're genuine, and they're often transient. Whereas emotions are interpretations. It can kind of spin out of control as well. Do you agree with that? Is this part of what you're saying?
Say it again.
Feelings are real. They're genuine. Uh-huh. They're usually in the moment, and they're often transient. Whereas emotions can become are often interpretations that last beyond the moment. They can spin way off the graph, like what we've seen in some of these examples.
Well, I mean, that's an okay, like, I won't say what I call that. It's mental gymnastics. Is that to me is that philosophically stimulating? Sure. Is that, you know, what they call it, navel gazing? Yeah, it's philosophically entertaining and provocative, but it's mental gymnastics. It isn't going to make a difference in my life that I know that emotions are interpretive, but feelings are real. It doesn't necessarily. That's not powerful to me, you know. And I'm not saying that that's bad or knocking it, George. But it's not powerful to me. It's more powerful to me realizing in the moment when I just had an interpretation that I mistook as fact. Can you see that? So
we've got someone with the mic. Just a second.
This is Michael again. I the fact that the chairs were left out is a fact, as far as I'm understanding the way you have us interpreting this.
Yes.
But the fact that we were not, or the reason that we were not present is your interpretation.
Yes.
Is that not true?
No, well, it's actually an interpretation that you weren't present.
But you don't know.
Yeah.
Whether
sure.
I was present or not.
For sure. You could have said, you know what? I'm really mad at a couple of people in my room. I'm going to leave this dang chair and watch this. Right? For all I know. Right? Sure.
So it is an interpretation.
It's an interpretation. Absolutely. 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 Great exercise. I'm glad I said that. Yeah, I'm busted. Yeah, absolutely. See how easy it is to do that?
Catch the coach.
Yeah, absolutely. Catch the coach. I threw out a possibility, but I didn't language it like a possibility. I almost languaged it like fact. I almost said to Kathy, these guys aren't present. She goes, what's that about? And I said, probably not being present. Very close to sliding into sounding factual, right? Like, I know. I don't know. I'm like, I could have said, that's a great question. Let's go ask. Now, when you ask, hey, you guys, you all left your chairs out, or a bunch of you left your chairs out. What's up with that? And if somebody says, I was totally focused on this conversation and just didn't even realize or whatever, then it's then it's factual. I call that running it to ground. Right? Run it to ground. I remember walking past my coworker's doorway one morning, and I said, good morning, Sally. And I got back this, no, morning. And right away, what do I start with in my head? Oh my God, did I forget to send a memo? Oh, crumb, she's mad at me. And I'm stewing inside, stewing. What did I do wrong? How many people do that?
Yeah.
Right away, it's personal, right? We take it all personal. Like it had anything to do with us, right? And so I stewed about it, went upstairs, like, and I'm running through my head. What did I? No, I got that memo. Did I say something offensive at the meeting yesterday? And I'm going, I stop. I walk downstairs. Sally, is everything okay? She said, yeah, I had an upset this morning coming to work. Like, okay, cool. Everything okay with me? Yeah, why? I'm like, oh, that'll so teach me, right? What do I think? The sun rises and sets on my back? I mean, really, you know? I'm like, okay, Jules, here's your next. You know, so I keep trying to prove to myself, don't take things personally. And if I am, I go run it to ground because I will not spend my time stewing and beating myself up inside for something I just completely manufactured. Yeah. All interpretation based on what?
Filters from your past.
Well, her hello. That's all she said. Good morning. And she said morning back. That's it. It takes that for a human being to go into like, oh, no. Oh, I gotta, maybe if I take her out for lunch or something, she won't be mad at me. We have no idea. We're now reacting, we're interacting with our own imagination and have no awareness. So Dexter also graciously pointed out to us ownership. And what he did is he really owned his interpretation. You know, so often we go through life and say, you know, it's because I grew up poor. It's because I grew up visually impaired that I am where I am or that I am who I am. You know, it's not, it's almost like saying it's not really my fault, right? Like we're the victim of the circumstances. So there are three stages that occur in ownership. Let me, Kathy, can you remind me what time we're done? Okay, oh my. Okay, guys, we're going to learn fast. There are three different stages for ownership, what I call personal ownership or personal accountability. So if you're going to really take on ownership of your thoughts, ownership of your feelings, ownership of your life, like I said earlier, all the parts that you love, you get to own them. And all the parts that you don't like so much, or you even hate, or you'd like to change, you get to embrace those too. You get to own them and say, I may not like them, but they're mine. I own it, and I have the ability to change it. So the first stage is, it's really looking at your mindset. So personal responsibility is one of the stages. So it's a before the fact mindset of personal ownership, and it's before results are produced. And then there's the second stage, and you can go back and forth between these stages all the time. So self-empowerment, to take action to ensure the risks, to ensure the achievement, to ensure the result. And then the third one, personal accountability, a personal willingness after the fact to take ownership without blame or fault. So that's a big one. That's a huge one for most people, is that can I take ownership of everything in my life I like and everything I don't like, no fault, no blame, no guilt. You know, you are where you are because you are where you are. So Dexter also pointed out, I should have had him come up and do this because he's just been, he's a plant. I planted all that. He's my plant to open up the conversation.
That's an interpretation.
That's a fact. I planted Dexter. No. What he was also pointing out is meaning-making machines. Is that we like to say, you know, it's about the economy, right? Or it's about my disability. It's about having less opportunities than other people. It's about the way I was raised. It's about my finances. It's about, you know, the state of the union. I mean, it could be anything, but it's certainly not, those statements don't reek of ownership. So can you think of comments that people have made or you've heard yourself making where you can start to see that's not owning? That's why I said earlier, let's not make like we the visually impaired, you know, that you can throw stuff out to the group, but you just want to notice that, not that that's bad or wrong, but you want to notice the language that we use. It's not I didn't feel heard as a child. It's, you know, lots of times us blind folk don't get listened to. Do you hear the difference? So one's ownership. Like, there's parts of my life I don't like, and you know, like it or not, I get to own it.
I hear, that's just the way I am.
Yeah.
And I immediately, I hear, not own. I'm a this, I'm a that.
Sure.
And we get into the I'mas.
Yeah, I'ma. You got the I'ma disease.
Julie?
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's just the way I am. Is that ownership or no ownership?
No, it's totally not.
Yeah.
Not ownership.
Some degree of not ownership anyway, huh?
She can have to leave that out of that over here.
I'll just talk loudly. I'll just stand up and talk loudly.
Okay.
Julie, this is Lisa. How do you address real injustices in the world?
Like, ten words or less, give me an injustice.
Like, if someone's not heard as a child, or if generally people of a certain age need to be heard more often, or that's just an example.
Yeah, so if you said, Mom, did you listen to me as a kid? And she says, no, never, then it's fact. Your mom didn't listen. That's all you know that's factual. You don't know that anybody else might have been listening, right? Can you see that?
Yeah.
If you say, Mom, did you listen to me? And Mom says, no. What you now know factual is that your mom didn't listen. Not everybody. That's interpretation. Oh, I'm so misunderstood. I'm so, you know, nobody hears me. I'm understood. That's interpretation. If you go around, though, and say, do you understand me? No. Do you understand me? No. Do you understand me? No. Oh, you know what? I'm thinking nobody understands me. Right? So you see how you're making it factual? If you're suspicious of it, you can see if it's factual. Check in with people around you. That's a whole different training, but you're pointing to something great, Lisa. Yeah, definitely. That's, you know, we need another couple hours here. So this was designed to you know, have you put something at stake, to introduce you to the world of coaching, and to have things start to open up even more that look at your human being. Because you can go into a job interview and you can say all kinds of really great stuff, but if they smell a rat, it's nothing that you say. It's in your vibe, it's in your energy, it's in your being. So that is definitely something to pay attention to, is who am I being while I'm walking through life? And we are going to do some private coaching sessions with Catherine and myself. So if you're interested, do they speak with you, Kathy? Do you want to tell?
Yeah, so there's, excuse me. There's going to be coaching available, but at 9:30, 10, and 10:30. So eight
That's
slots.
Tomorrow.
Yeah, so eight
morning,
slots.
Morning, a.m. Not
so
tonight.
Not tonight.
be too much
if
vino.
If you're interested, after the time, just come up to the front, and we'll offer some more times, too. So come up after the front. After tomorrow?
Yeah, 9 o'clock, 9:30, 10 a.m. or 10:30. So you can sign up with Catherine or myself to do some coaching. So have something specific that you really want some coaching in, because 30 minutes can be a little bit of laser coaching. So one of the courses that I did, we had to start our share with whatever we were going to say. Not that this general necessarily applies, but we had to start with, and the point is, so it cut out a lot of preamble. So the 30 minutes isn't going to be enough to cover your whole life. But there, you know, and if you're not clear, it will help you get clear in the first 5 minutes. Is what do you want to get out of this 30 minutes? Where do you want to be at the end of this 30 minutes? Then if we need to schedule some more stuff, we can do that. So if you're interested, you can see Kathy after. Sign up with Catherine or myself at 9 a.m., 9:30 a.m., 10 a.m., or 10:30 a.m., and then we'll make some other times available as we go through the week. And thank you so much for sharing and looking, you guys, and looking inward. It's a brave thing.